Hello. Happy Sunday morning to all the brothers and sisters and children in Christ that may be joining us this Sunday morning. I want to ask you to continue, once opportunity presents itself, guided by the Holy Spirit, that you continue to support Taylor financially. We are blessed by all the giving that you all do. So many of you have subscribed to this YouTube channel, and so many of you sent a plethora of compliments we can use to financial support, as we are so very active in the ministries here at Taylor. This Sunday morning, the sermon will be talking about Jesus knocking at the door and the gifts that Jesus gives to us, his children. So I pray that this Sunday you become blessed once again by the sermon, also by our sister Althea Battles singing, and that we enjoy this spiritual journey together. God bless you all. Amen.
God bless you, Taylor. What a wonderful Sunday morning to give God some praise. Oh, what a mighty God we serve. He has brought us through so much, and may he continue to bring us into the marvelous light. First, giving honor to God, who is the head of my life, to our pastor, Pastor Anthony Jenkins, and his lovely wife, our First Lady Valerie Jenkins, to all of our church leaders in ministry. I just want to encourage you, because we have definitely taken a great loss, one of our own, one of God's angels, our sister Terry. May she rest in peace. And I just want to share with you that Terry really, really, truly touched my life. Not just my heart, but she touched my life. I will never forget one Sunday morning when she returned back to church from being ill. She gave me a big hug, and she shared something with me that will stick with me for the rest of my life. And she told me when she was in the hospital, whenever she would close her eyes, she could hear me singing. How blessed I felt to be used in such a way by our mighty God. So sometimes we have to do things that God wants us to do for his good. Even when we're just singing and praising, we don't really know who we're touching and who we're helping. That is one of the best testimonies I've ever bared witness to, and I thank God for her sharing that with me. So, in honor of using God's gifts, because it's nothing that I'm doing, it's everything that he's doing. This week's ushering in the message song is "I Give Myself Away" by William McDowell, and I do not own the rights to this music. And if you know this song, please sing along with me. I give myself away. Give myself away so you can use me. I give myself away. Come on, wherever you are, even if you're in the midst of your living room, sing. I give myself away so you can use me. I give myself away. Anybody know what that means, to just give yourself unto the Lord?
so you can use me. Here I am, here I stand, Lord, my life is in your hands, Lord, I'm longing to see your desires revealed in myself away.
Anybody willing to give themselves away?
I give myself away so you can use me. I give myself away. Oh Lord, I give myself away so you can use me. Take my heart, take my life as a living sacrifice. All my dreams, all my plans, Lord, I place them in your hands. Myself away, oh Lord, Lord, I give myself away so you can use me. Oh Lord, I give myself myself, I give myself to you. My life is not my own. To you I belong. I give myself to you.
Come on, why don't you repeat that with me?
My life is not my own.
To you I belong.
I give myself,
I give myself to you.
Oh, sing with me. My life is not my own. To you I belong. I give myself to you. Lord, my life is not my own. To you I belong,
myself,
I give myself to you. Oh Lord, my life is not my own. To you I belong, I give myself to you. My life is not my own. To you I belong. I give myself to you.
We'll miss you, Terry.
I'd like to share a scripture with you this morning. I will be coming out of the New Testament, the last book in the canon, book number 66, and that is the book of Revelation, and I'll be sharing one verse with you, and this will be part one, and I will be reading for you Revelations chapter 3, verse 20. God's word says this from the King James Version. Behold, I stand at the door and I knock. And if any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come in to him and will sup with him and he with me. That's an invitation from God to us all. To us all. Please join me in prayer. God, we humbly come before you. And so often, God, I say that we come humbly because once we begin to focus on you and all that you are, we cannot help but to prostrate ourselves before you spiritually and physically, and recognizing who you are and who we are. And that humbles us. It humbles us, God, because of your glory, your greatness, your unconditional love. And we sometimes forget that even in the midst of our trials, even in the midst of our challenges, God, that you are yet in control. And sometimes, God, we become discombobulated. We seem off balance in life, oh God, because things aren't going the way we thought they should or the way we planned for them to. Let us surrender to your plan. Let us surrender to your will, and whatever that is, and whatever mountain that puts before us. But let us be mindful that we are not alone, and you have prepared us. And we pray this prayer in Jesus' name, amen. The title of the sermon today, brothers and sisters, is Answer the Door, It's Jesus. I want to repeat that. Answer the door, it's Jesus. In this sermon, in this scripture, the Bible is teaching us about how Jesus comes to us, but it is our responsibility to open the door, to open the door to the one that we have faith in, to open the door to the one that gives us mercy, to open the door to the one that gives us grace, to open the door to the one that is standing there knocking with unconditional love for us, but also answer the door to the one that gives us salvation, the one that unlocks the door into eternity for us. Answer the door. You know, I believe that Jesus is our gift. As we just celebrated last month about Christmas, Jesus is our gift. He's not just a gift to Joseph and to Mary and the children of Israel and others of that time, but he is the gift that literally keeps on giving. He is our gift. Then why is it sometimes we say with our mouths that we are Christians? That we say with our mouths that we are believers? But does our actions equate that? There's a saying that states simply this: it's not what you say, but it's what you do. It's not what you say, but it's what you do. There's so many people that claim Christianity and say, I'm a Christian and I'm a Christian. There are even those that can recite scripture from beginning all the way to the end. But reciting the Bible doesn't matter as much as living the Bible. So like the saying, it's not what you say, it's what you do, because what you do drowns out what you say. Woo! Let me say that again. What you do drowns out what you say. Jesus says that he's at the door. Some of us say, yeah, we've let him in, but have we truly? You know, God gives us all gifts. When we are his children, he gives us these gifts. And a lot of times, we are afraid of the gift. You know, it's like we have a fear of the gift that God gives us. So therefore, we never put it into action. And therefore, because we don't put those gifts in action, we have not answered the door. Pastor, tell me deeper about what you're saying. What I am saying is that we are saying that we're going to the door to answer it. But as Christians, I'm going to date myself, and maybe you're going to have to call your mom or your dad to understand what it is that I'm saying. But it was different with life insurance salespeople than it is today. Today, you go on the computer and you can get insurance, or you can call and you can get insurance. But it wasn't like that when I was growing up. Like I said, you might have to ask your mom and dad. Because back then, in the 30s, the 40s, the 50s, the 60s, the 70s, the way that the insurance person did is that they would come to your door. The insurance man would come to your door with his briefcase or with his folder, and he would ring the doorbell, and you would let the insurance person in, and then you would pay them, and they would give you a receipt. But there were door-to-door insurance salespeople. My point being that back in those days, this is before color TVs and all of that, this is what would happen because folks' money was tight. Folks was really scratching out a living. So what would happen in those days is that the insurance man, he would pull up and he'd see your car, or he may not see a car in the driveway because folks didn't have two and three cars like they do now. And what they would do is they would come to the door and they would ring the doorbell. Or they would come to the door and they would knock. And this would be the actions of some people in the house. Shh. Don't say nothing. It's the insurance man at the door. Shh. Turn the TV down. The insurance man outside rings the doorbell, then after not hearing anything, puts their ear to the door. The parents would tell the children, shh, 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 be quiet. Don't say anything. Don't let the baby cry. Shh, shh, shh. Everybody in the house is frozen. The insurance man would knock again. House is quiet. Nobody's saying anything. And then you would hear the insurance man's footsteps go off the porch and down. And you would hear their car start up and drive off. And then usually, one of the parents would go to the door like this. They would barely move the curtain and look out. Oh, it's okay now, they're gone. That's the way some of us treat Jesus. That's the way some of us treat Jesus when we have an ulterior motive. When we got something else going on in our mind and we want things to go the way we want them to go. See, Jesus does this. When Jesus gives you a gift, and he gives us all gifts, but it usually invokes pain. It usually invokes challenge. It usually invokes chaos. And so because we have these gifts, we become fearful of our gifts. We don't exercise what God has called us to. We don't move as God has called us to with the gifts. Because every time that you get a gift, different than on Christmas, because I won't say that we're afraid of the gift, but sometimes we're afraid of the wrapping paper that's on the gift. Because when God gives us a gift, it usually invokes challenge in some kind of way in our lives. Yes, it will bless us. It'll eventually bless us. It'll eventually uplift us. It'll eventually take us somewhere that we haven't been before. But before that happens, the challenge comes. The challenge comes. It's like the children of Israel. Ah, let me take you somewhere different first. It reminds me of when I had moved from a smaller church to a larger church. And I remember that, and I remember taking my grandmother, and I was like, I'm going to take my grandmother out for a special meal. I'm going to take her out. And so I went and picked up Granny, and we were together, and I drove her to this very, very posh, beautiful, nice restaurant. And I was so proud to be taking my grandmother to this restaurant. And we walked in, and the waiter met us, and he was clean and well-dressed and had the white linen napkin over his arms, and the waiter escorted us in, and I stood up and he pulled back the chair for my grandmother, and my grandmother sat down and he assisted her in moving forward to the table, and he took off the cloth napkin and popped it and gently laid it across her lap, and then I sat down, and he then placed this beautiful menu in front of her, a beautiful large menu with so many different things on it, and he did the same for me. And then I could just sense something. And if anybody has a mom or a grandmother and they got deep love for them, they may remember that you could literally feel when you're growing up your mom looking at you. You can tell when your mom is looking at you. She may not have said anything, but you could feel, as her child, you could feel her eyes upon you. Well, I was reading, looking at my menu, and I looked up because I felt her presence. And my grandmother's eyes was looking across the very top of it at me. And so I set my menu down, and I said, Granny, what's wrong? And she says, Anthony, because she don't call me pastor when she was alive, Anthony, have you looked at these prices? And I said, Granny, don't worry about them. Your grandson wants to treat you, and I want you to have this delivery, but have you looked at the prices? Is that what we do with the gifts that God has given us? Ooh. Are we willing to pay the price for the gift that God has given you? Are you willing? Because challenge is going to come with your gifts. I don't care who you are. I don't care how gifted you are. Challenges are going to come. And that's what happened right there with my grandmother. It was a gift. Don't worry about the price, because the blessing is going to come. That's what God is going to do with us. But there's going to be a sacrifice. There's going to be some challenges you have to meet. There's going to be some valleys with your gifts. It just is going to be that way, because it's in those valleys that God is molding us with his potter's hands. It's in those challenges that God is preparing us for the mountaintop. Oh, Joshua in the Old Testament, chapter 5 and chapter 6, the land of milk and honey. The land of milk and honey. What were the challenges? They had to cross the Red Sea. First, they had to leave Pharaoh. Then they had to cross the Red Sea. Then some of them were hungry. And some of them were thirsty. And even though God provided, they kept murmuring about the awaiting blessing. There are blessings that are awaiting all of us, but they murmured about them. And then, so that age group, those people didn't make it. They were fed by Jesus, and God gave them the water. He gave them the water from the rock. He gave them manna from heaven. He fed them. He gave them the water. He did all of that. but they were so murmuring about the awaiting blessing that they never made it to it. But their children did. And their children listened to the murmuring of their dads. They listened to the murmuring of their mother. And so when they got to the Jordan River, what they did, the men had to be circumcised. Circumcised with no Novocaine. Circumcised with nothing to numb them. Oh, I mean, this is a painful, painful thing. It's painful for a baby, but it's even more painful for grown men. But they didn't murmur. They didn't murmur. See what I'm trying to share with you, brothers and sisters, that we can be in this situation even with this pandemic. And it's getting worse and worse and worse. But nothing, I've preached it, nothing takes God by surprise. And yes, I've lost some loved ones. And yes, I've been concerned about myself. I'm not saying don't be concerned, but don't forget to keep praising God. Don't forget to keep thanking God. Look what happened in Joshua 6. They thought that the men thought that they were done with the pain when they had finished getting circumcised and they crossed over. And then they enjoyed crossing over so much, they left stones in the water in the Jordan River to remind their subsequent generations that they went through what was necessary to come to the land of milk and honey. But when they got there, a whole nother battle began. A whole nother battle began. A battle of betrayal by someone that lived in their same community. Have you ever been betrayed? Then a straight to the battle of Jericho. But their blessing was yet in front of them. Have you become blinded by this pandemic? Have you been talking and it seems to be that that's the whole trajectory of your conversation? Have you worried so much at certain times that you've forgotten about Jesus? Have you forgotten that God is in control? Just like he was during the plagues of the Old Testament, have you forgotten? Don't you know that the distractions of life, when the door is being knocked upon by Jesus, that you don't even hear it's Jesus because you're hypnotized by your TV or you're entrenched in the telephone conversation that's going on? Or you've been so afraid that you treat Jesus like the insurance man, that you tiptoe and you need everything to be just perfect, perfectly quiet, perfect in your life. Then, is that when you say you'll open the door? Is that when you begin to trust Jesus, when there's a vaccination and your hope is in the vaccination rather than of the giver and creator of it? Because no man creates anything, because God creates man and woman. Have you forgotten? Have you forgotten? I'm gonna ask you a question. How many times last week did you talk about the pandemic? How many times last week did you talk about the epidemic? How many times last week did you talk about the vaccination? How many times last week did you talk about politics? How much last week did you talk about Jesus? How many times did you talk about your Savior? How many times, or did you use him as a bullet point? Have a complete conversation about everything that's going on, about what's around you and what's going on in the world, and say, but it's gonna be all right, Jesus got it. Well, did your conversation start off like it? Was Jesus in the midst of it, huh? Was Jesus in all of the words that you used about the pandemic or the vaccination or the politics? How much did you talk about Jesus? Oh, because if you didn't talk about Jesus like you talked about all these other things, maybe you haven't answered the door. That's the thought for you to think on before we get to part two. Amen. I hope you enjoyed the sermon today. I did, as the Holy Spirit continued to move me about where does the majority of my conversation rest. I want you to be in prayer with me and Taylor concerning Terry Holloway, my baby cousin who died a couple of weeks ago. I want you to be in prayer with me about her, but not for her, because God's word says to be absent from the body for believers is to be present with the Lord. But my young cousin, mother, I'd like you to be in prayer with me for my Aunt Eve, my Aunt Evelyn. I would like for you to be in prayer with me for her sister Cynthia and her nieces and nephews and for all of her family. Terry was a young, vibrant, Jesus-fearing, Jesus-loving Christian. And my young cousin was such a help aid to me here at Taylor. My wife had, through her tears, was when we found out about Terry, she was telling me, she said, honey, when I came to the church, Terry came up to me that day and said, hi, I'm your husband's cousin. My name is Terry. And she said from that day, Terry never changed, that she always would call my wife and give her support and give her hugs on Sunday morning. Terry was involved in so many different areas of this church. And I will forever miss her. I used to go to her high school when she was younger and I was an athlete, and I would go to her high school because most of the athletes knew me, and I would be like, this is my cousin, Terry Green Eyes. And they'd be like, Green Eyes is your cousin? And so her and I would talk about that and get laughs from that. But now she is with our Lord. And I pray that her family, that we get just some of the peace that she's receiving right now from being with Jesus. I want to offer up another prayer that you join me in, and it's for Ron Cross and his wife, Patty. Patty has been stricken with a very, very serious cancer, and she's just an angel. Do you know anybody that's just an angel? She is an angel, and every time that I'm in her presence, she blesses me. Her husband, Ron, blesses me. Patty is a believer. In fact, Patty and Ron are United Methodists in another state. He is so hurt, yet he keeps his boldness of faith in Jesus Christ. And Patty is doing the same. You know, the Bible says that the flesh is weak, but the spirit is strong. One day I'm going to preach about that and really let you get a deeper understanding. But that's Patty and Ron. Ron's hurting because he sees what's going on with Patty. I ask that you pray, whatever state you're in tonight, when you get on your knees, because this is what my wife and I do with our prayer list. Tonight, when you get on your knees, pray for Ron and pray for Patty Cross. I love them dearly. God loves them most, and I thank God for inserting them into my life. With that said, I want you to remember, let your conversation be more about Jesus than anything negative, about anything that is afflicting you, because Jesus is the answer. And we should celebrate who He is in our life far more than we celebrate anything else. No matter what's hurting, no matter what's ailing a parent, a child, a friend, or a spouse, go to the door and open it. And He said He will come in and He will sup with you. Invite Jesus in right now. Amen.